big revelation of the 100th episode was, at that occasion, Julia and Michael and I finally saw and read the testing results.
The brass of NBC read this letter.
Supporting cast, uninteresting, lose them. No potential for growth.
The test audience felt that the supporting cast was not strong enough and that Jerry himself was a weak lead.
It was very good timing because, you know, on that occasion, it was something we could look at and just laugh about.
My favorite thing in the testing is that the show is considered contemporary, unusual, humorous, and appealing to young adults. Therefore, not something that we would want.
I recall for the 100th episode, we were given a little paperweight that said Seinfeld 100. That's what I recall. I don't remember anything beyond that, really.
Well, it was a great feeling to hit 100. Really a good feeling.
I could tell that 100th episode was very cherished, and it was just great being there to be a part of it.
Have you ever considered wearing something for support? Now look at this. Mind you, this is just a prototype.
You want me to wear a bra?
No. A bra is for ladies. Meet the bro.
There was a debate between whether it was called Man's Ear or a bro, and we had written it as a bro, and Larry was like, no, Man's Ear is a better name.
And I looked in my drawer, and I went, I got this giant jog bra. So I drug it in there. I said, what about this? And they went, yeah, that'll work.
You know, you read about people coming up with some idea, and it works out. They make millions.
The Man's Ear was so popular that GQ Quarterly actually put out a product a couple of months later in which they were actually an upper body support for men.
But we all agreed the notion of Frank Costanza having large breasts would be funny.
I think that was really the first show I worked very, very closely with Jerry Stiller.
Michael was very meticulous about the way he worked. I made up a line about him. I said, he had a mercurial mind in a weightless body.
I remember the routine we created. We were just given carte blanche to just work out some business, just keep the cameras going.
We'd work it out. Then we'd get on camera, forget it. We just do whatever we wanted to do.
Really lucked out with Larry Miller in that episode too. Yeah. That was a great character.
He was my best friend, still is, and he ended up playing the part of the doorman.
I was struck by how relaxed Larry Miller was as a sort of vicious doorman.
Woo, woo, woo.
Can I help you?
Yeah, I'm just going up to see Elaine Benes.
Benes. There's no one here by that name.
Oh, she's house sitting for Mr. Pitt.
Ah, house sitter.
Yeah.
What are you, the boyfriend? Here for a quickie?
So we were doing a scene from The Doorman where Kramer's, I think, holding a typewriter or something, and walking down the sidewalk, and people begin to spot him.
A recreation of the scene from Marathon Man walking down the street that I scored in similar fashion.
I think that came out of Larry. Where Larry, you know, one thing about it'd be great where you'd be sitting with Larry with your script and every once in a while you go like, I got it. And then with that one, he just started acting out that part and he was totally into it.
Two minutes before the show ended, Larry ran up with us. He says, do this, do this. I said, what is it? You're in bed with George. And he says, you're eating kasha. I says, what? He says, you just eat the kasha.
In that moment, it took a few takes for Jason.
Thank you. Kasha?
Jason just couldn't get through it. He just busted up every time. And we must have did like 12 takes of that before we got a decent take.
Couldn't get through it.